Thank you again for the invitation. Okay, first of all, we would like to read the letter from Paolo Sanzini, who was a good friend of Sergei Konakov and who worked with him during the last years. The organizers of the Landau Days, 2014. Thank you again for the invitation. I am very sorry I cannot participate in the Memorial Day dedicated to Sergei Vinokov. And I feel very sad about it. What makes me feel better, however, is that Piotr Grinevich will present at this Memorial Day our recent results on the mathematically rigorous aspects of the IST theory for vector fields and dispersionless PDEs that Sergei and I developed during the last years of his life. Putting this IST theory on a solid mathematical ground was indeed, for Sergei, one of the most important open problems to be solved. As far as I am concerned, I will always recognize the very influential role played by Sergei in my scientific life, and I will always miss the extremely brilliant scientist and the loyal friend. Best regards and best wishes for a successful meeting. Paolo Maria Santini. There is a talk by three collaborators. This is Paolo Santini, Der Schuh and me. And the purpose, at least we show that we put some constraints, and at least analytical constraints, which are of course not optimal, and we show that if we impose the analytical constraint, the equation which you call Pavlov equation, the Cauchy problem, has a regular solution. First of all, I wanted, maybe before doing it, to make some important remarks that when the Soliton theory was developed, originally we studied the system which we call system with dispersion. Of course, important examples are Kotlebnev, Friis equation, Linear Schrodinger equation, Stein-Gordon equation, Hudson-Kvitt-Gerashvili equation, and many others. Usually, we have either high-order differential equation, differential operator in the last part, so we have some matrix operator. In any case, we have operator which some proper spectral theory or maybe some generalization. And the theory of the system with non-zero dispersion, I think now it's well developed. Of course, we can, first of all, such systems very often afford soliton solutions, which is important. Sometimes also it's important that usually we can apply some version of Dressen method. We can apply sometimes Darboux transformation. We can construct finite gap solution. So a lot was done. But also another important class, which we call dispersionless system of hydrodynamical type equations. Of course, I think they are also integrable in some sense, but the two classes of integral systems are essentially different. First of all, usually they don't have soliton solutions, naively. Also, if you have zero dispersion, you may have some wave breaking. One important result was also mentioned by Vladimir Evgeniech, that Monakov-Santini obtained analytical description of the wave breaking. So, of course, it's an important result. And sometimes dispersionless system has wave breaking, sometimes it may have not.
And wave breaking is used for wave on the ocean, it's a completely different system.
Yes.
It's the wave breaking problem of the shallow water, yeah.
Yes. Shallow water. Yes. And also, important observation, I think I would like to refer the paper by Zakharov and Shabbat, where this paper, when they have shown that if we consider vector fields in the Lux sphere, we can obtain systems which are truly multidimensional. Because it's interesting that you have a lot of classic integrable soliton systems with one or two special variables, But usually you would like to go to higher dimensions, more. It's almost, I think it's almost no example of equations with dispersion. But dispersionless equations, as it was shown here, they may have arbitrary many special spatial variables. So also it's one of the reasons why the systems are, of course the systems are also interesting. Of course, the system, sometimes they arose if you consider the small dispersion limit and take the system as a first approximation. But what happens? You know that if you have liquid with very low viscosity, of course, the behavior obtains more and more complicated. Low viscosity limit, in some sense, it's very complicated because you have turbulence. And also, in some sense, dispersion regularizes the solution. If you have shock wave, and if you have dispersion, instead of shock wave, you obtain maybe some oscillations. But nevertheless, dispersion regularizes. It destroys the singularities. But in case of zero dispersion, you can have proper shock waves. Because, of course, you have no dissipation. Therefore, the limit of small dispersion is very important. And the last, maybe the first I would like to mention this one plus one systems with the Dubrovnik file also. I think I also mentioned the papers by Zakharov that this consider this integrable system in multi-dimensional integral system with quasi-classical limit. And of course, the last years, Sergei Monarchov and Paolo Santini, they invest a lot of efforts to develop to obtain some analog of Dressing method for system with zero dispersion. The situation is the following. They were very beautiful results, but unfortunately, the methods which we used are rather far from being rigorous. So, for example, they have operators. They have unbounded operators, and sometimes they treated unbounded operators as bounded one. Of course, you understand that. And Sergei Monarchov always asked me and Paolo that it would be very important to develop also to make more or less strict theory, at least at physical level. And it turned out that, unfortunately, it's not a very simple matter. And what we decided, in some sense, was Paolo, we decided to do call this equation, which in some hidden form it was obtained, it was appeared in paper. But Martin Salonso, but I think explicitly this equation was first written by Maxim Pavlov. And what is interesting? Mathematically, the simplest equation, unfortunately, is not the most interesting from the physical point of view. But it turned out that from the mathematical point of view, it's the simplest equation. You have one time and two space variables with zero dispersion. And for it, at least, we now succeeded to write direct and inverse spectral transform sufficiently rigorous. And at least we show that assume that we consider the Cauchy data. Assume that the Cauchy data is sufficiently small. Later, I will tell you what does it mean exactly. Sufficiently small. And we show that if you start from sufficiently small data, the solution of Cauchy problem exists of infinite time for every positive t. So we can solve Cauchy problem for this. May take the exact definitions later, if you don't mind. I will formulate. Small, it means that you have some estimates on the integrals of the first four derivatives. So we assume that we have some estimates on the first four derivatives. Also, in this paper, we assume that the Gaussian data has complex support. It's not very natural, but we simply did it because the analytical estimates are rather complicated and long. And to avoid also extra analytical, we put this not very natural condition. Of course, we have no doubt that this condition could be replaced by some proper Sobrev spaces, but at least we wanted to finish something. Therefore, we put maybe this not very natural condition that the Cauchy data is not. This has complex support. First of all, let me, maybe it's good to mention, there are also some interesting. First of all, dispersion less equation. This Kantz-Petrashvili also famous as Kozlov-Zabolotsky equation. Maybe the first paper where it was in physics we have found this one, 48, where it was derived. Of course, it was derived also in many other models. And it can be represented as a commutativity condition for the following linear operators. I think this. First, I would like to mention the paper by Krichilier, where it was suggested a method for constructing solutions of this equation. This Lux pair representation arose in this, was derived in this paper, this Lux pair. I would like to mention that in these equations, it was important that you can write either nonlinear analog, because it's quite classical linear. If we take quite classical approximation, of course, recognize linear equations, the classical approximation, became nonlinear. So you may use nonlinear Lux pairs. Another approach, we can write Hamilton-Jacobi equation. It's quite classical linear. And the Hamilton-Jacobi equation gives us a linear Lux pair. And of course, there are two different approaches, which are not completely equivalent. And the problem which one is better, it depends on the. I'd like to mention also this paper when it was, by the classical D-bar method, was derived. The only problem is that in this paper, it was, some scheme was suggested, but the analytical aspects of the approach were not studied properly. Another, maybe some other example, for example, this equation in n plus 4 dimensions, very highly dimensional system, it has this last representation. Maybe I can show another example. You can write this reduction, also you have the Lux pairs. It's Hamiltonian equation, which second heavenly equation of Klebanski, which is some special reduction of the Einstein equation. This two-dimensional special is total lattice, and also the system of two nonlinear PDEs. First, describing subgeneral integral Einstein wide metric. This first was derived in the dissertation by Dunajski, and let me point the following. Consider the Lux pair. We have first order Lux pair. We have first order graphs. We have vector fields. What is the difference? For the vector fields, you don't have the proper spectral theory. But first of all, let me point out what is the difference between first order operators and higher order operators. Assume you have first order operators and you have a pair of solutions. Okay. You have a pair of solutions. If you have first order operators, that also the product. If the zero eigenfunctions, the first order operators form an algebra. I would like, if you have linear operators of high order, you can add eigenfunctions, but we couldn't multiply it. But if we have first order operator, the product of eigenfunctions is an eigenfunction thing. We have an algebra of eigenfunctions. And it also creates some advantages and disadvantages.
And also it means that the spectral problem may not be. If you have higher order operator, usually, in the inverse problem, use linear equations. But if you have first order operator, we may have nonlinear equations in the inverse problem.
Also, let me write now it's how to measure the result. I would like to press that Malakoff and Santini in his works,
they used two different approaches.
Either they used non-linear Riemann-Hilbert problem, or they used some similar integral equations.
In our paper, we work with singular integral equations. Unfortunately, it's...
And I would like to stress, of course, I would like...
Okay, let me maybe recall. What is in the KP case? You have something like this equation, something like this, KP1. You have some contour. You have real line, and you have equation. Side. It's for KP, we have this linear relation. You have one derivative problem, you have functions which are holomorphic upstairs, downstairs, and the values upstairs and downstairs are related by some linear relation. In the dispersionless case, the difference is that instead of linear relations, we use some. Have something like this. You have some nonlinear, you have some substitution operator. I mentioned that we have algebra of functions, therefore, instead of linear equation, we have nonlinear. And of course, one of the technicalities that you have to be more careful by choosing the functional space. First of all, we put this condition. And now, let me describe the construction. How? Of course, there are two steps. First, we have inverse direct and inverse problem. How to solve the Cauchy problem for the Pavlov equation? We assume that we have the Cauchy data, V0 of x, y. So we assume that it's smooth, has complex support. The direct problem, we introduce
some Pavlov equation is a limit. For what dispersion?
I don't know.
It comes from what integral here?
I don't know.
Universal hierarchy, Chapat, Martinus Alonso.
Yes.
More or less.
Okay. First of all, we start reconstruction.
Some sketch, of course, we have. What, how we are doing? We have the Cauchy data, we construct some spectral data, and then we write the evolution of spectral data, and we reconstruct the solution using the inverse problem. Let me describe all the steps.
First of step, how to construct the spectral data by the Cauchy data? There are two steps. First step, we construct what we call scattering data. We consider the eigenvalue problem. And we construct your solutions. Your Jost solutions are solutions with the following symptotics. We have Jost solutions with sine plus and minus, correspond to the equation, and y goes to plus and minus infinity. And how to construct Jost solutions? It's very easy. We know that if you have first order equation, the solutions of the equations are functions which are constant on the trajectories of ordinary differential equation. Of course, it's valid if lambda is real. For complex lambda, it's more delicate. But assume that lambda is real. To construct IV pumps, we simply solve the differential equation and we put this asymptotics. We also we assumed you have the form of asymptotics. Therefore, and we see that the simply the Yost solutions are defined by this formula. So it's rather simple. And then we have the following. We have two Yost solutions, psi plus and psi minus. And it's easy to check that psi minus and psi plus are connected by this formula. Of course, we have solution which normalizes at plus infinity and minus infinity. Of course, we can express one through another. So this, we call the function psi, the scattering data. The second step. We would like to construct the eigenfunctions which are analytic in lambda. Of course, it became more delicate. We have vector field, but vector field with complex values, it could not be treated very naively. But fortunately, for Pavlov equation, it's not a big problem. This equation eigenfunction can be written as Beltrami equation with this potential. And you see that the modulo of this function is smaller than 1. And fortunately, Beltrami equation, it was well studied in conformal geometry. So for you see that for each lambda, such solution does exist. Moreover, how to solve it? You assume that imaginary lambda is very small. What? First of all, I tell that we have this equation has solution, the second statement, that the solution with the asymptotic that at infinity psi goes to z, this solution is holomorphic in lambda. I would like to stress that we solve Beltrami equation in z, but the resultant solution is holomorphic in spectral parameter. It's easy, it is a statement, but you it's easy statement. But now what happens if lambda is very small? We make this change of variables. What happens if lambda is very small? You have the following picture. The picture is shrink very seriously. Therefore, all the potentials located in a very small strip, and outside the strip, the trajectories are straight lines. Because the potential is zero. And we see that the eigenfunctions are always constant on the potentials. If imaginary part of lambda is zero, they are constant. If imaginary part of lambda is non-zero but small, the solutions are almost constant. Therefore, in the limit we see that the value here is equal to value here, almost equal. In the limit, they are equal. Therefore, we see that we obtain the shifted Riemann problem. Because the value at this point is equal to the value of this point. It means exactly this identity. We have the shifted Riemann problem. And we have this property. And we see that, of course, the just eigenfunction gives us a Hollow invasion. So we can express the holomorphic function in terms of just once. And the function chi minus will be called the spectral data. And we can calculate the function chi plus and chi minus from this identity. Due to the fact that chi plus and chi minus are holomorphic in the first argument, and they are holomorphic in the first argument in upper and lower half planes simultaneously. I would like to stress that it's very similar to the original famous paper by Sergei Monakov, who studied KP1. Also for KP1, he constructed the scattering data in two steps. First of all, he constructed the classical scattering data, and then he solved some equations, some factorization equation, to construct the Riemann-Hilbert data. So there's two steps. And here is something which is similar to the original paper by Sergei Monakov. Okay, now it's an easy statement. How to describe the dynamics, the time dynamics of data? It's very simple. You remember that usually if you have system with dispersion, we have exponents, and here instead you have this linear dynamics. And now let me write the inverse problem. You simply use the following. H lambda denotes the Hilbert transform. And what is the property? Assume that you have the analytic function. The function is analytic if and only if the real part and the imaginary part are related by the Hilbert transform. It's a very simple exercise. How to check this function is analytic, for example, in lower half plane? Necessary is sufficient condition that has the following relation between the real and the imaginary part. Some very simple exercise. Therefore, it means exactly that this function is analytic in the lower half plane. It has forms of integral equation. And of course, how to solve the integral equation? Solve the integral equation, of course, we use the analytical method. First of all, we know that in space L2, this operator is unitary. Therefore, it's rather good equation because we have unitary operator. And assume that we have the following property. That these two derivatives are small enough. Of course, if we have the following constraints on the derivatives, then we see that this operator is contracted and we can solve the equation simply by using some operations. Maybe the only delicate matter in which space we have to solve this equation. We show that we have solved the equation with L2 intersection then infinity. Okay. The next step you do the following. Of course, to calculate the derivative of the wave function, you have to solve the linearized equation, you put a little stronger constraint, and we obtain the following. If we have this constraint on the spectral data, then the functions omega and these derivatives belong to space L2, and psi satisfies the log square for the power of equation. And also we have integral formula for the v, vx, vy, and the functions are well defined. Let me point out that in this list you don't have vt. Of course, you may say that nothing bad, because if you have a look to this equation, you don't have vt. You have vx, vy, vxx, vxy, vxt, vyy. And this equation is not resolved in terms of vt, but it's very typical. Consider the Kanzashvili equation. It's rather famous that there are so-called Markov constraints. If you don't impose Markov constraint, that at time zero, the derivative of v is not very good at time zero. For all positive t, the potential loses the localization.
So the integral by y, by x doesn't depend on y, right?
Yes, at least you have, the normalization may depend on y to obtain this. It's a little delicate, maybe. Moreover, it's not completely finished. No, of course, it happens if you don't impose constraints. For positive t, we have solutions which decay slow, but for positive t, it's okay. You remember, it was studied for KP that if at all positive times, all Markov constraints are fulfilled. But you have slow decay. Here is also something like this. For positive t, vt is well defined, but it's well defined only for positive t. For zero t, we have some problems. And now, let me formulate the last result. Okay, assume we have Cauchy data. Let's calculate the following integrals. B0, B1, B2, B3.
Покажите
еще
раз ту систему, которую вы смотрите. Решаете. Это Павлов уровень.
Да.
Has it any Hamiltonian structure? Yes. Can you construct a Hamiltonian for this system?
Oh, maybe I have to see it. Okay. And maybe the last thing from this fall. Okay, we define the following. Okay, we define B0, B1, B2, B3. This is some expressions. Also B0 hat, B1 hat. We define some. Okay. And assume that we have the following property. The potential has compact support, and we have the following estimates on the constants. Some inequalities. If you have the following estimates on the potential, you wrote. Of course, the, first of all, maybe it's not necessary at all. Maybe it's not the property of the system. Maybe we simply don't know how to solve the system result. But maybe it's not necessary. But at least if the constraints are fulfilled, we can show that the inverse problem, the operator is contracted, and we can solve it. We don't know. Maybe it's, at least if you have, this is some constraints. Yeah. Okay, this is the definition. So if you assume that the potential satisfies all the constraints, then we show that the Gaussian data has a unique solution. At least, in fact, we simply show that these constraints are...
At the time?
Yes. It's... But, okay, maybe I don't... But it's possible that arguments by Monakoff-Santini show that in this system, what is the difference? In the dispersional SKP, we have inside some... We have also time inside the integral equation, which solves the inverse problem. And therefore, we have wave breaking. Here, this Monakoff and Santini approach doesn't predict no wave breaking. Predict no breaking. Therefore, at least this result is in agreement with predictions with what Monakoff Santini did, maybe not very strictly, but nevertheless, so it's not surprising that it's, yes, its solution exists for any time. But it's maybe one of the reasons why we succeeded. Because in some sense, let me repeat again. This equation is mathematically simplest. In this case, we are looking under the street light in some sense. Of course, it's more ambitious problem to understand what happens with dispersion SKP. But this equation is simpler. Because in dispersion, okay, let me show. Some sense explanation is the following. If you consider the system, you would see. We have that we have x, y, and lambda derivative. And if we have x, y, and lambda derivative, we don't know also for the dispersionless KP. We succeeded to construct holomorphic eigenfunctions only outside some strip near the real line. So, till now, we don't know how to prove some existence of eigenfunctions. Because, of course, the idea is the following. We invert this operator, and we take operator this one times the inversion of this one. But this operator is unbounded. And if you deal with unbounded operators, you can prove too much.
For almost all dispersionless, you know for sure that there would be singularity.
Yes.
So if you find a situation with no singularity for t equals 0, it will inevitably singularity will appear. So that's why I don't know what.
No, but it seems that it's
just. No, as I say, not for part, but for KP,
yes.
Almost all.
Yes. No, but and we decided at least to finish some. So this moment we are doing what we can do in some sense. But for Pavlov equation, at least it's more or less correspond to the previous experience that this equation has no singularities. But maybe due to maybe the simplest one. Maybe it's, of course, it would be interesting. So here's the last remark, okay, that what happens at t equals 0, maybe it's another question we'd like to study. And also remark, we have the condition of the scattering data. What happens if we consider scattering data without this condition? We obtain the same solution, but we obtain different normalization of the wave function. Maybe I would like to finish.
Okay. So, questions, remarks?
Show me the equation. So it's, I have a simple question. So, this one, yeah. If, for instance, let's say the second term is absent. In such a case, it seems to me that it's an integrable system by hand. Is it okay? Is it right? No. Let's imagine that the second term is absent.
Why?
Is it seems to me that it's a so-called Inviski-Prandtl equation. And in such a case, as I know, because of Inviski-Prandtl equation can be solved by hand, so without any scattering transform, and so just some simple manipulation, and it follows from this solution that breaking.
It's inevitable.
Isn't so here? No, as I understand.
So,
maybe it's necessary. Yes, it's a good question.
Okay. Okay. So, more questions, remarks? Okay, let us end this video again.
Нет,